Evidence-based dentistry has been defined as combining our clinical experience and expertise, along with best research evidence and patient preferences, to improve clinical decision-making and ultimately outcomes of care. So how does evidence-based decision-making compare with a traditional model? Traditional decisions in dental practice have tended to be more linear in nature. When faced with condition A, always do treatment B to achieve or avoid outcome C. For example, when a patient has a missing tooth, it must always be replaced to avoid arch collapse. As a dental student, I was given information by clinical instructors, some of which was based on science, some of which was anecdotal, with little ability to discriminate which is which. Everything here is something that was told to me by a dental school instructor, none of which is based on quality science. And for some of these, we actually have evidence that suggests just the opposite is true. Evidence-based decisions are more circular in nature. Thus, if a patient is missing a tooth, we should consider the evidence on replacement of missing teeth, which would include survival rates for implants compared with fixed bridges, as well as no replacement, while considering both our clinical experience and patient preferences as well. Now, this is an evidence pyramid illustrating the hierarchy of evidence. Practitioners may think that as one goes up the pyramid from one type of study to the next, the quality of the evidence improves. However, it is possible to have a high-quality cohort study and a poorly done randomized trial. What does change as we move up the pyramid is that both bias and confounding are actually reduced because both bias and confounding can distort the results of a study. We are more likely to obtain the truth as we move up the evidence chain. So what type of evidence should be at the very top of the pyramid? Well, that would be clinical practice guidelines, which is when an expert panel convenes and performs an exhaustive review of the literature referred to as a systematic review. Clinical practice guidelines do two things. One, they summarize the evidence on a particular topic, and secondly, they provide clinical recommendations for practitioners. This is a recent clinical practice guideline done by the ADA on sealants. The results of this guideline stated an odds ratio of 0.24. In plain English, this means that sealants compared to no sealants reduce the odds of caries by 76%. Fluoride rinses, varnishes, and gels, on average, reduce caries risk by only about 24%. Now, this may be surprising to the practitioner, but the magnitude of effect of reducing caries risk is actually much greater for sealants than it is for topical fluorides. And sealants have become a prime example of where we have good evidence that is not getting into practice. In a recent study, Tellez and colleagues found that only 40% of dentists routinely use sealants in their practices. A qualitative study by O'Donnell and colleagues found that practitioners were hesitant to place sealants due to a variety of reasons, including a lack of awareness, or in some case, mistrust of guidelines or reimbursement issues. Another recent ADA clinical practice guideline examined dental procedures and prosthetic joint infection. This clinical practice guideline essentially asked two questions. Is there an association between dental procedures and PJI? And do prophylactic antibiotics reduce the risk of PJI? The clinical practice guideline included four case control studies, and this evidence failed to find an association between dental procedures and PJI. Additionally, there is evidence that prophylactic antibiotics do not reduce the risk of PJI. If there is no benefit from antibiotics, then practitioners must look at the harms of antibiotic usage on both an individual and population basis. This would include anaphylaxis and C. diff infections for individuals and antibiotic resistance, morbidity, mortality, and healthcare costs on a population level. Currently, there is good evidence that dental procedures do in fact cause bacteremia. However, there is no evidence that this bacteremia causes PJI. Additionally, the effects of antibiotic premedication on bacteremia are actually unclear, and bacteremia can also be caused by activities of daily living, such as eating and toothbrushing. Practitioners may commonly be concerned with not premedicating a patient with a prosthetic joint for dental procedures. Yet with no evidence for benefit, there actually should be greater concern for potential harms of giving prophylactic antibiotics for these patients. So what are the take-homes here? Well, first, evidence-based dentistry incorporates clinical experience, research evidence, and patient preferences. Secondly, clinical practice guidelines are at the top of the evidence pyramid. Third, the ADA guideline on sealants represents a guideline suggesting practitioners begin implementing an intervention. And lastly, the ADA guideline on PJI represents a guideline suggesting practitioners discontinue an intervention. For more EBD resources, visit ebd.ada.org.